Yeah, two Larrys together. So the bios are in the program, and I encourage you to look at those, but certainly give the panel an opportunity to introduce themselves. And we'll start with Larry.
Well, good morning. I'm Larry Boris. I serve as President and CEO of the Midwest Business Group on Health, which is a large nonprofit business coalition in Chicago, representing about 130 companies, about 4 million lives, spending over $4 billion in healthcare. I also serve as head of the National Association of Worksite Health Centers, which is a new organization to help employers and others who have on-site and near-site clinics, pharmacies, fitness and wellness centers. My group provides an overview represented by HR benefit managers of self-funded large companies like Boeing, Walgreens, Abbott Labs, Chrysler, Ford, Target, et cetera, and try to focus on how to get more value from their healthcare benefit dollars.
Good morning, my name is John Harrington. I don't know who that man is in my picture, but I'm the real John Harrington. I'm pleased to be with you. I retired from Sanofi a few years ago, where I was the chief commercial officer for our oncology division. Especially for the students out there, I'm what's known as a dinosaur. I spent my entire career in the legacy companies of Sanofi, going through five different mergers. So my three most recent experiences, I ran the diabetes business unit in the United States, I ran the oncology business unit in the United States, and I retired as the chief commercial officer for our oncology division that we marketed into 93 different countries around the world. So I had a great opportunity, Dan, to see how some of these other systems ultimately innovate, how they pay for, and how they regulate this industry. Upon retiring, I've decided I'd do some teaching in the school that I went to and bring the business of biotech to Stonehill College, a small liberal arts school in Massachusetts, and I do a little bit of consulting as well.
Awesome.
Good morning. My name is Larry Aldrich, and I'm delighted to be here and be part of this panel. And I'm probably the accidental tourist in healthcare. I've spent most of my career as an attorney and an engineer, most of my working career in the newspaper business of all things, back when we made a lot of money in newspapers and ran the papers down in Tucson for a number of years, and found my way onto the board and eventually into the company of what was then called University Visions Healthcare, which was the clinical arm of the University of Arizona's College of Medicine. So when our doctors saw patients, they saw them through our organization. I became general counsel and then became CEO, and we ended up merging UPH with University Medical Center in Tucson. I always say that when you saw that tragic shooting of Gabby Giffords and so forth, those were my doctors working at University Medical Center. They were not UMC doctors. We merged, and that's the organization that Banner now owns, probably the only, I think it is the only academic medical center in the country that's focused on, owned by a non-for-profit, which is a little bit interesting, to say the least. And I've read Dan's book. It's a great book. I highly recommend it. And I probably disagree with some of the fundamentals in his book, so we might get into some of that. But thank you for having me here.
Absolutely. So, John, let's start with you, in part because your former organization had a pretty spectacular announcement this week, and it relates very directly to both innovation and how that's happening.
It really does, Dan. So that Sanofi has been in a collaboration with Regeneron since about 2002. And yesterday it was announced that it will be introducing a new product for a very select condition of atopic eczema, think of it that way. But also because it's a new and innovative compound, it will see that it will also have application in other therapeutic areas as well, including asthma. When you think about the number of patients it would serve in the United States, it would probably be about 300,000 for the atopic dermatitis portion, but clearly a larger indication will present itself as they file their phase 2 and phase 3 data in the area of asthma. Now, it's important to note that the company should learn, because in two previous cases where it went into the VEGF area, the vascular endothelial growth factor, to compete against Avastin. And then more recently, 3 or 4 years ago, went into the PSK9 area. Issues of pricing became an issue. And for those of you who might have seen the McKinsey article a couple of years ago after the storm, it talks about 65% of all products that are ultimately approved fail. And they most often fail for two very, very basic reasons. One, they've misstated the degree of clinical differentiation and benefit that is provided. So they don't view themselves. Is this truly a breakthrough? And then the second, they fall into the trap of not understanding the issue of pricing. So it's my distinct hope that Sanofi and Regeneron will get this right. I can tell you I was there for the one case where they got it wrong, and it's a painful, painful situation when you get it wrong. And in the second case with the PSK9 situation, not only do we run into an issue of pricing, of where they took a product for cholesterol, really hypercholesterolemia, where patients are treated with statins, but all of a sudden now we saw a segment of those patients that could be treated with these PSK9 products and ultimately priced it at $14,000. The payers and the technology advisors came back and said it's a great innovation. Might be worth a quarter of that in the market. So you're right, Dan, I've seen that's a great example of innovation. It's a great example of three different cases, and it will be very interesting to see how this plays out with this new innovation that was announced yesterday.
Awesome. So Larry, Boris, you're representing the group health sort of market. How does innovation play out relative to what you're seeing?
So employers are the purchasers of healthcare. They pay the plans who pay the providers who provide care to the patients. But they don't do this because they're altruistic. And they do it because they have to compete on the global marketplace with all the firms and organizations where the countries are paying for healthcare. So they have to find the most efficient, the most effective, most innovative ways to provide care. So innovation is really key in understanding how do I keep people on the job, because, as I said, employers are not altruistic. They don't offer healthcare because it's nice. They offer it to keep people on the job, to recruit and retain talent. So many of them have thought, well, if the healthcare system is so dysfunctional and fragmented, if it's so complex and misunderstood, then maybe I should start delivering care myself. So over 30% of employers now offer on-site and near-site clinics. 60% run by nurse practitioners, physician assistants. They're offering everything from someone coming in a couple of days a week to do some health coaching, to a group like Disney or Cisco offering a 20,000 square foot operation, offering medical and dental and vision care and pharmacy care and innovation. You check in, there's no waiting time. All the data, all the healthcare records are shared with the individuals. The systems they've developed integrate biometric screening, health assessment, group claims, disability claims, performance on the job, satisfaction, life skills, the problems that they have at home and community. The mass and use of data is really where innovation is taking place and how it's being delivered. Employers have historically offered a variety of fitness trackers, and now getting into more of the wearable devices. They're finding that you can now combine all the information where people are active, how they're active. Are they participating in programs? Are they staying fit? Are they eating correctly? How does all that contain, and how does that relate to their performance on the job? Because again, at the end of the day, it's how much are they performing widgets? How are their calls? How are their negotiations? How are deliveries being developed? But there's all these concerns with great innovation. Because now we have, what about data breaches? Everybody who has a wearable device going into an employer location, particularly if there's security issues, has to now be concerned on people being able to take that data, get that information. So at the end of the day, we want to make sure that people are healthy, productive, but that care is delivered in an efficient fashion. So we've talked about medical homes and ACOs, retail clinics, urgent care, freestanding centers. But you've got to have it in an effective way. It's got to be lower cost. It's got to help people because you want to do wellness programs not to people but for people. You want to help them, and the only way to do that is to be where they are, using the tools and instruments and devices that they're using to give them care. So such things as the telemedicine activities and all of these. So I would say within 5-10 years, maybe half of primary care will be done outside doctors' offices. This will lower costs. This will keep people at their jobs because they can get care and information and instructions and prescriptions at the job and early. It'll avoid the need to have to do things on weekends and nights. So, Dan, in general, innovation is important as long as, again, from an employer's perspective, it helps people stay on the job, keeps them healthy, and is protective of their information and reduces costs.
So, Larry, are you seeing the same thing relative to the employer side?
I'm seeing efforts, but what I'm seeing is a failure of understanding of what's the problem. And I mentioned in my introduction that the disagreement. My view in this world is the notion of having more health insurance is one of the goofiest things that we are focused on. You know, we definitely want more access to health care. We don't want more access to health insurance, but we've conflated that. We believe if we don't have health insurance, we don't have care, and that's simply nuts. So I think what employers have failed to understand is how are they going to deliver care and help their workforce, families, and their employees access that. So some of the on-site clinics are some ways, but they often seem to continue to have this flaw, which is about the payment side, and we haven't really gotten down and understood what that is. And then we see the charts that Dan put up about, you know, life expectancy and everything else, and, you know, the data is so flawed, and it's being driven by insurance companies that have gone up 500, 600, 800% during the last 10 years as the economy's gone up 250, 300%. And why? Because they have more coverage. So Obamacare doubled down on health insurance. TrumpCare wants to triple down on it. It's crazy. And I think the employers should step back and say, we want to make sure our people are as healthy as possible. We want to figure out how to do that. Nobody really wants more care than they need. How do we keep them healthy? Frankly, how do we hold our own individuals accountable to stay healthy? You're on the job. You got to show up. I pay you a decent salary. You know, you damn well better access your health care appropriately. You can go work for somebody else. But we're unwilling to enter into the right conversations, in my view. And oh, by the way, when I ran companies, I never asked these questions either. Nobody, I wish somebody had said to me, why didn't you stop doing that? And we've been like, well, that's a really good idea. So what would we do else? So I think these are all small experiments that aren't really looking at underlying all this. How do we get people the right care at the right time, in the right place, at the right cost that gets them as healthy as it can be? And I don't believe insurance is the answer.
Fair enough. So speaking of price, is $37,000 sort of the right number for an innovation that Sanofi represents with this new drug?
Well, Dan, the market's going to vote on this here pretty quickly, I think. So what do we know? We know that this is seen as a true medical innovation, that there is nothing that's out there that will compete with it. Other products that are available for treatment right now, the side effect profile, they're prohibitive in terms of their impact on patients. Now you say to yourself, well, geez, you know, we're talking about atopic dermatitis. That doesn't sound like we're talking about ovarian cancer, or we're not talking about pancreatic cancer. How difficult is this? People suffering from this, the acuity of people suffering from this, it literally disables them in terms of their ability to be able to lead a more normal life. Now, what I would hope, and again, I've been away from the company, I'm not here representing either Regeneron or Sanofi, is that somebody has really tried to model a fact, is this medication worth $3,000 a month as it relates to offset of other costs? So would people be hospitalized? Would people be back in a more intensive system of care? And I think, I will tell you, I think that this system of pricing drugs is probably toward its end of its cycle. This is what's happened with rare diseases. My sense is what you're going to see pretty soon. People are going to really say in a transparent way, how much did this cost to develop this product? And those costs are very significant. And those costs, we've got to figure out a better way so drugs don't cost $1.2 billion and take 10 years to develop. So we've got to first take a look at that, but let's get a realistic look at what the cost is. Let's look what the have a better understanding of what a fair appreciation for the cost of capital is, and then let's also take a look at cost of goods and charge that. The notion that you can charge just because you have an innovation that now no longer makes the patient or the system incur those costs, I think that that's a system that probably is running its course. And you will see, and this administration is gonna put intense pressure on building a business case of why you charge what you charge for medication. So early on, you know, the stock market didn't go crazy yesterday. Regeneron and Sanofi, you know, you would have thought that if they hit this right and they said that this is a $3 billion, there's some organizations, some financial services organizations, see, this might be as big as a $5 billion product, but it did not necessarily, as of yesterday, tick the meter up that way.
Right. And I think the feedback that I've seen so far is that Wall Street is unhappy with the pricing. And sort of the patient community is unhappy with the pricing. So maybe that's the right balance, is that's sort of where we may be needed to head in terms of getting to the sort of right price. Larry, we're seeing a lot of chatter and a lot of conversation around value-based care. Is that something the employers are focused on as well?
I think that's the theme of this decade, is value-based. And what is value? Value is essentially, you know, what's the cost of the services and what are you getting out from those costs? So we're seeing now a trend, and it started back when the HMO Act was formed, where you have, how do you identify the best providers to go to? How do you identify the best hospitals or doctors? How do you identify the best of most effective drugs when you have a variety of options? Give you an example. Number, when I started my career at the Illinois State Medical Society back in 1973, we used to look at the members of our organizations, and there's always a bell-shaped curve. You had those very high performers, you had most of the docs in the middle, and then you had low performers in the side. And at the medical society, we always felt, well, we need to help those lower performers move up and be better doctors. Now that I'm on the purchaser side, I will tell you, in a value-based system, we're cutting that bell-shaped curve in half, and we're getting rid of all those low-performing doctors. We don't care. We only want to be with the high-performing physicians who follow evidence-based practice, who have data showing that they get people out of the hospital, back to work early, that they offer efficient care, that there's no readmissions, that they coordinate care, same with hospitals, same with other kinds of vendors and providers. So, and employees are now being incentivized to only use those. So you hear about high performance systems and narrow networks. We're looking at value-based formularies. So the most effective drug, regardless of whether it's brand or generic, would be on the first tier. The ability of employers to get engaged and talking to people about what is the outcome, what is the pharmaeconomics, how quickly will a new drug get people back to work? If new drugs come out and they don't improve someone's productivity and they're mainly there to help the quality of their life, frankly, employers don't care because they are not being productive. If what I'm paying for doesn't help someone help the bottom of line my company, oh yeah, and they are concerned about their human capital. There's no doubt about that. But it still comes down to what's the value of this drug to my employees as they are human capital for my company. So value-based purchasing, value-based negotiation and contracting and benefit design is all fundamental, and Medicare is taking a real lead in this. I mean, one of the important things to remember about the ACA was it was a lot more than private public exchanges. That was just chapter one, providing coverage for people. Second chapter was reforming insurance, but the third chapter is where we are most interested in. It promoted and incentivized changing the way we pay for and deliver healthcare. And that is where value-based purchasing and design is going. And that, I think, will continue regardless of what happens with the ACA.
Larry, with the Health Alliance, are you seeing the same thing in the sense of fee-for-service shifting to value-based?
I think we're seeing it, and I think the hard part is I don't think it's going to get where we want to get to. I mean, the research is pretty clear. When we talk value, we're talking price and quality. When any individual, average person in America sees lower costs, they equate that to lower quality. The research is absolutely clear. So you have this conundrum because we haven't had the right conversations on how to help individuals navigate. There are 90 million, pick a number out of the air, 90 million employed Americans, not the 150 coverage, but the 90 million between the ages of 16 and 65. Half of those people make less than $15 an hour. I mean, think about that. Half of employed Americans, full-time work, make less than $15 an hour. Can you ever expect them to navigate their way through a system as complicated as healthcare? And so what's really been missing on these value-based assumptions is it's kind of between, let's say it's the TPA insurance company and the employer and the systems. What they've taken out of the equation is the navigation that those individuals need to think about. Some of that navigation comes economically, because some of that comes in, there's some really interesting experiments on variable deductibilities being driven to, when you go to a high-priced provider, you pay a higher deductible. Some of that's reference-based pricing. But I think, really looking for ways to help individuals, especially probably none of them represented in this room, people making $15 an hour or less and not helping them navigate. I'll tell you, the insurance company, they have no interest in being navigated by the insurance company. They don't trust the insurance company. They have little interest in being navigated by their employer. They don't trust their employer. What they do trust, their medical professional. They do trust the system, the doctors. They don't trust the hospital, they trust the doctors. How do you put in place some better navigation to help them make those better value-based choices? So I think we've kind of put a solution. We've created high deductible plans and HSAs. People making $15 an hour, you give them a $5,000 deductible. Are you kidding? You think that's going to work? And they don't worry about going bankrupt for $250,000. They worry about paying the $500 bill. So again, a lot of these are, let's make a speech, cut a ribbon, done that all the time, make a new policy, implement value-based purchasing without thinking about the hard work ahead to see if it's going to work. And that's my worry about value. Conceptually, great, but you don't have engaged the people at the table who are accessing the care, and where are they getting that information? Off of Angie's List or off of Yelp? I mean, it's crazy, but it's what we've built.
So one of the things that came up pretty quickly here is we're in the cycle for the federal budget, and one of the big line items that keeps coming up recently is NIH funding. And the last I heard is that it's $1.2 billion that they're planning to cut this year, with I think a $5.8 billion cut in 2018. That's a significant number. And that goes to the heart of sort of innovation relative to being the incubator for some of this early stage. Is that something that you're concerned by?
Yeah, so let me say this. I really do think having the ability to be in a position where I saw how the rest of the world handled healthcare and innovation, I don't think enough people really recognize the importance of the National Institute of Health. I mean, I really do think it's this little gem in this little incredible, important area of innovation, and especially incubation. When we think about chemotherapy, when we think about paclitaxel, it was years ago that those scientists in Bethesda and Rockville, Maryland, really developed the first understanding of that. And that follows all the way through now to checkpoint inhibitors. I think that the fact that there are multiple different chapters focusing, whether it's oncology, whether it's in cardiovascular health, whether it's musculoskeletal, there is a real, this is what the government can do well in terms of funding initial investigation and initial innovation, and finding a way to seed it relatively inexpensively. Now, I would also say this, from spending 37 years in my life in a private company, do I believe there's any budget within a private company that you could probably find 10 to 15% waste? You bet. And if you go into a government area, that number would probably be at least that large. But the notion that you would take that away from primary research, especially in the areas of new science, because it's my belief that the science has never been more exciting right now based upon unlocking the Human Genome Project. But I will tell you, the financing it and paying for it has never been more challenged. And soon, we might be at the point of being able to unlock more cures and innovation that either society, insurance companies, or individuals are going to be able to pay. But to your point, Dan, I think that the National Institute of Health, especially at the point of the spear of its five major areas of focus, their basic research budget should be something that we as a society see as a treasure and probably shouldn't be reduced.
Right. So bigger picture behind that, though, is the funding, the federal budget line item for HHS, which is scheduled for what looks to be, at least at the first blush, about a $12 billion haircut. Do group businesses see that as any kind of a challenge, or is there any impact to that for group managers?
Well, there's concern. You know, ARC is part of that area that's being deleted as well, and the Agency for Healthcare Quality and Research for years has been promoting opportunities and funding conferences and funding research and encouraging research and publications on all kinds of things relating to what employers are doing in wellness, in value-based purchasing, and group involvement in healthcare. I think if you look at the CDC and their whole worksite efforts in wellness and things to help particularly smaller employers. My members tend to be large self-funded. They're pretty much going to do what they're going to do, and they have the resources to. But the vast majority of employers really benefit from what HHS has done, and before that, other groups, county health departments, state health departments, the kind of programs that are out there, the screening. You know, people don't recognize, though, employers are a key part of the public health system. They probably do more in preventive services and screenings and flu shots and other kinds of things, and they really contribute. And when funding is cut back, then there's more of a burden on employers to do something because there's no resources in the local community. But the kind of guidance and direction, I mean, HHS and CDC do quarterly meetings on the Zika virus for employers. And on other things that affect the travel, and of course most of our companies are globally involved in other areas, how are we going to get this kind of information? Because employers, as they've downsized their factories, have downsized benefit offices. So a lot of times they do rely on their health plan, they rely on their consultant, they rely on what they can hear from the government, but they're not getting as much information as they used to, and with these cuts coming about, there's less people that they can go to. So I think it will impact us, and it'll impact probably the mid and smaller ones more so.
How about you, Larry? Also the same with the HHS funding cut proposed, any effects that you're seeing?
My struggle with all of this stuff is, you know, everybody wants, it's like Christmas morning. I want more presents over my parents to pay for it. So I fundamentally think we got to cut spending across the board. And I just wish Trump administration would have said, I'm going to cut spending, I'm also going to cut taxes, and then I'm going to say to the states, if I'm going to shift these services back to the states, closer to the public, you're going to have to increase your taxes. You know, but nobody does. Everybody shifts to their priorities. We still pay a lot more taxes, and then we get more defense or borders or whatever is the latest thing. So there's no question there's waste. I think the real question is, what are you trying to accomplish? I mean, I do think in the EPA side, the argument, whether you agree with it or not, is so much of that enforcement is occurring at the state level. Let's have the states manage that. Cross-border issues are where the feds should be. Same thing on health services. What are you trying to manage? Are you trying to get this issue closer to the people, to the employers, to whoever's paying the bills, and try to figure it out? And the distance from Washington to Phoenix to an employee is ridiculously long, and trying to manage that from Washington, and you know, and we haven't talked about single payer, and I'm not a big single payer fan because I think we're in ground zero of the VA. It proves to you the federal government can't deliver healthcare. Here's ground zero at the VA here in Phoenix. So let's start thinking about how do we get some of the decision making, some of the authority, some of the cost, and some of the revenue, you know, closer to the individual that we're trying to deal with. We always talk about those people that are never in the room. How do we get those people in the room to say, what's the problem? How do we provide? And I guarantee you, we can get all the regulation out and we can get all the distance out. we can use that money more efficiently. So cutting, you know, HHS by 20% is a rounding error from that perspective. So focus those efforts on local employers, people that are providing the health care, that's the history we have, and then try to figure, help those employers think about ways they can deliver, help their employees get access to care in a more effective way. And there's a number of great experiments going on in Phoenix on that.
So John, you, the Trump campaign was pretty big on targeting pharmaceutical companies specifically for using Medicare to negotiate pricing. Then he met with the pharmaceutical company folks, and are we still seeing that same appetite for using Medicare as a lever on pricing?
Yeah, you know, it's obviously a very interesting election cycle. Let's go back even before the election and think of when Hillary Clinton had made her announcement in terms of looking at what she wanted to do in the biotech sector. There was a 27% drop in what occurred in the value of biotech companies in that week. So think about it. So clearly, there is a target as it relates to pricing. There is a desire, I think, to be able to leverage that, as your graph showed, quite frankly, in the United States, better than 55% of healthcare is directed now by CMS. So what they want to be able to do is to put those big arms up on the table and wrestle the industry to a different price point. Now, what we've also heard is the ability also, and something I think that we should think about, and I would ask for any of us who have connections in other parts of the world or in Asia or in Europe, we also are looking at reimportation. And should we be looking at reimportation from Canada? The one thing I would ask for most people to really think about is the ability for the FDA to be able to regulate plants and where are issues of both quality and purification really occurring. And this isn't an idle threat. If you look in Europe right now, one of the biggest issues you have is counterfeit medication. So you pay maybe slightly less for the medication, but you might not be getting the actual purified product. So I'm all for figuring out a way of creating more competition. But let's not do it in any way that would put the health and safety of the American public at risk.
Right.
Clearly, Medicare is going to want to put its, and CMS is going to want to put its big arms up on the table, and they will have an impact in terms of how prices are ultimately determined.
Larry, you represent organizations that are at the front edge of some of the innovation. Are there ones that you can highlight in particular that come to mind that really sort of crystallize what the best innovations are that you're seeing through employers?
You know, I really can't do that. We have 13 pharmaceutical companies as members, and we have a variety of other groups, but it wouldn't be fair for me to say this is good or
that. I mean, just scrub the name and give us an example of where...
I'm not in the ability to do that.
Got it. Okay. Larry, I'll swing back to you. So employers are a key element on the road ahead. They obviously have a huge influence. Are there specific innovations that you're seeing that make sense for scaling to broader employers and broader organizations?
Yeah, I don't have any hesitation on names, so obviously the lawyer has a different ethical set than the non-lawyer. But full disclosure, the company I'm going to share is, they're friends of mine, they're running buddies, I have no economic interest, I'm not on their board, I just like what they're doing. But many of you in this room have heard of Redirect Health, and if you haven't, go to redirecthealth.com. And basically, the innovation is, you know, think of how innovative this is. We're going to provide the people, again, that mostly those people who aren't getting the coverage that you all have or don't understand it, the right navigation and the right free primary care. No deductible, no copayment, no co-insurance, you know, telephone access when you want it, free generics, free images, free labs, and they do that for their employers at $105 a month. So, you know, I don't know what the average payment in the state, I should have because I was on a board of a health plan here, but, you know, it's about $400. So for $105 just for the primary care, and so much of what they do is that navigation. You know, that's the person at the end of the phone where you can pick up and say, my kid's got 101 temperature, I don't know what to do, I need to get a prescription, I think I need to talk to my doctor. They are the people to help you think through that. They're trained, they're educated, they have a 24/7 call center to deal with that. They're fully integrated with the care, so the people calling don't think they're talking to some, you know, telemedicine firm in Indonesia. It can't happen under our regulatory scheme, but people think that. So, you know, those are the innovations here in Phoenix, and there's many of them. I mean, there's, you know, new direct primary care innovations, there's concierge innovations. The reality is those are all focused on the higher paid people in the world. And if you go to direct primary care, you're talking about taking, it used to be 3,000 patients, Medicare patients used to be the standard. It's gotten so ridiculous with the regulation and paperwork that the number is closer to 1,500. Direct primary care is one third of that. If you had everybody go to direct primary care, you would not have enough doctors, you wouldn't have enough providers in America. So that's a bad model because it just is starting to cream skim. But there are many of them like that are trying to provide care, worrying less about coverage and more about care and more about helping that average mom who just doesn't know what to do have an answer of where she should go and understanding the economic consequence. If she makes a choice to go to this hospital versus this hospital, that hospital is going to cost you $5,000 out of pocket and that one's going to be $1,500. That's the navigation. This is not rocket science. It's pretty straightforward, but we have basically left those people helpless, and I think some of the innovations are providing that help.
Dan, if I could comment, I will mention Santa Fe.
Absolutely.
But the innovation I want to talk to relates to what Larry's commented as well, which is the economics. Santa Fe, when it first came out with the PSK9s, came to us and said, we understand specialty drugs are a real problem for employers. They're high cost. There's a lot of waste of people being on the wrong drug or having the wrong dose or not being prescribed correctly. So we want to have an innovative approach to how it's going to be offered. So we only will promote this to doctors. We will tell doctors if only patients who can't be on statins anymore or are not effective should be prescribed this. We will tell the patient, we'll try, they'll be on a trial. If that trial doesn't work, we will not charge for the drug. These were things we have never heard from a pharmaceutical company before. These are things, we actually promoted this as an approach, because what we're starting, we're looking at the biologics, the specialty drugs, because that is representing for some employers over 50% not only of their pharmacy spend, but of their total medical spend. We're now looking at how can we make the management and the use, because no employer wants to not offer miracle drugs to their employee who needs them, particularly if it's a top senior person or if it's a fundamental key person in the organization. Employers don't offer benefits just based on where people work or their value. But the bottom line is we have identified there are so many middlemen between the manufacturer and the time it gets to the patient. We're trying now to evaluate what's the value of all these people in between, the PBMs, the wholesalers, the retail pharmacists, all of those add revenue margins on. And we're trying to see, should there be innovation in how we contract for these drugs? And we're looking at where the drugs are offered. Do they have to be in hospitals? Why can't they be at a doctor's office or at the home or at an on-site clinic? So we're looking at different strategies, and that's for us, Dan, where the innovation is going to take place, is the delivery of care, how you make it available, and the great uses. We have been talking about things like initial limited fill. Why should someone get a 90-day supply of a biologic they've never been on and a dose they've never been on, and after 2 days they decide they don't want it and they've thrown out this drug that costs $5,000 a month or more? That's fundamental, and that's where employers are looking to the industry and others to say, how can you help us understand the ultimate consumer, the ultimate patient who's going to be the recipient of this value, drug or device, et cetera? How can we make it so they're getting at the right time, the right dose, the right person, the right setting, and it's going to make them, again, effective and healthy?
Hey, Larry, to a point that I think something else of what the new science is going to be able to do is to make sure it's that right patient. So it's not everybody that needs a statin. It is these patients that will need it. And that is medically proven. So that not only will you eliminate overuse, you will eliminate waste, and also what you probably will also eliminate is that you're not going to give this to a patient that's going to cause an untoward side effect that's either going to hospitalize them or cause other rescue. What it will do, it clearly narrows the market, but it's the right patient for the right treatment, for the right outcome. And that's where I think that you're starting to see, and even to the point of being able to have this in some kind of an involvement to be able to say, if you cannot prove that, if this does not occur, now we've got to pick the right measures, you know what, company? You're not going to get paid. So that ultimately tells the pharmaceutical industry that the game is changing. Let's get the right measures. Let's make sure it's the right patient. Because this should be the golden age of discovery. This should be, with the Human Genomic Project, the medications that are tailored for individual needs. I'm working with a company right now that's developing personalized cancer vaccines. And Dan, this is fascinating. They're going to build this for each and every person. So this is not, you know, there's probably 250 people in the room. What they would want to be able to use for me for lung cancer would be dramatically different than you. They're going to build this to your own genetic code. Now, how you ultimately figure out how you scale that and manufacture it, but you want to talk about an N of one. You're literally building this for each individual. And that's unlocking unbelievable, exciting science, but even on the manufacturing side, how you ultimately produce this in a way that could be then reasonably priced.
So it begs the question, though, because that sort of front ends the higher risk associated with N equals one. How do we get FDA and Scott, you know, Gottlieb is the new candidate. So is that thumbs up in the sense of the pharmaceutical industry?
Well, you know, I think that the industry now, this might be, we're at a point right now, and I take my hat off to the previous administration, that Secretary Hamburg, I think she did a pretty nice job in terms of recognizing innovation, beginning to put a fast-track model in. This wasn't all bad. Take a look at the history in terms of products ultimately being approved. I think in some of this new innovation, you're finding now the industry has got to educate the regulators. The good people sitting at the FDA, they weren't trained in this. So how they ultimately partner with, whether it's a National Institute of Health where, you know, incubation's occurring, the other academies of science, people have got to learn this to regulate it. And that, I think, is one of the, that's the diffusion of knowledge that needs to occur in partnership between the industry, between the regulators, to ultimately get to a better solution for patients.
And also, Dan, when you look at the ACA and the efforts to change it, that third chapter I talked about include PCORI. PCORI, which was created and funded, is being funded by a dollar or $2 per employee by every employer in this country to pay for comparisons of products, devices, drugs, procedures, and treatments to see what's most effective. Because we don't have anything like it, what is it, NICE in England that does that kind of comparison. We currently don't have anything like this. But PCORI, if it's not funded correctly and if it doesn't do what it's supposed to do, will fall into this trap of, again, not knowing what works best.
So we have about 10 minutes, almost 15 minutes left. I want to make sure the panel gets enough time to sort of wrap up with closing remarks. But going back once more to pharmaceutical, I hate to do that, but it's sort of pivotal in the sense of, especially where we are here in Arizona, there's a fair, and one of the stories I'm anticipating for later this year is actually traveling with an elderly family, an elderly couple that avail themselves of our location to sort of go down to Mexico and in effect afford drugs that they can't necessarily afford here. Is that a challenge for the pharmaceutical industry relative to sort of bleeding out of pricing, or how does that?
Yeah, so that's an interesting and a very volatile question. So where is the, and what's occurring right now is there's a much greater transparency in terms of what pricing is. This is what has occurred now both in Europe, where they're, while the EMEA was 41 countries, but you had different pricing in Germany, you had different pricing in Italy. There was a strategy in terms of how you went to the company, to countries that priced higher, so that ultimately by the time you got to the lower price, you still had some sort of a median issue. So there still is. Now, let me just say this too, that if you go tomorrow to buy a Lexus in Mexico City, that price in Mexico City is going to be different than it is here in Scottsdale, Arizona. So in many cases, countries are also, they take innovation in terms of where the innovation comes from, but then they price it to what the market can bear and pay for in that individual country. So clearly that's a big issue, and clearly with more transparency, people will know and understand where the prices are in different countries.
Could I just pick up on the, and I look out in this audience to the extent I can see everybody with the bright lights, but a lot of younger people in this room than I am. So, this is your generation and your opportunity to move up in your companies. But, put the issues around the, how do the companies solve this problem? I'm on a very different end of the political spectrum than most, but my notion is it's absolutely crazy that the FDA continues to regulate efficacy. They have to regulate safety. We used to have that in airlines. It's called the Civil Aeronautics Board. We now have airline safety, not price regulation. You can argue whether it's good or bad, but we have a much different economic equation. If we could eliminate the FDA around the question of efficacy and put in place with the right payment and the right choices so people understand whether something works, would it demand that the industry have good pharmacoeconomic analysis to say whether this high-priced drug actually cures somebody, improves somebody, whatever. And getting all this regulation out of Washington out of the way, it's never going to happen. It's not going to happen. But there's at least some arguments to say, if you all, in your plan, with your situations, we're able to make those choices better with the right navigation to help you make those choices, I think all these problems start to go away. But instead, everything's layered on by all the middlemen that Larry talked about, the pharmacy benefit manager. It's crazy, and there's so little line of sight from the person receiving the care to the person paying for it. And we just have to start thinking about it from an employer perspective of how do we get more controls around these issues and solve more problems. And I think that the FDA is kind of me, like, central casting, bad person, because they're doing it with very good intentions. They really think their job, and it is their job under the FDA laws, to regulate efficacy. But we pay an extraordinary price for that. And are there other ways, other models, other ways to get our drugs on the market faster? To obviously pay attention to safety as we start to roll these out with many more people. Obviously, there's some liability questions. There's a lot of things to work through. Lawyers love the liability questions. And think about other options that might enable the Sanofis of the world to put more drugs on the market faster. Doesn't take them 12, 15 years at a cost of billions of dollars. They can do it for $100 million in 3 or 4 years. There are ways to do that. But nobody wants to have that conversation. So I think you all are in your companies or organizations, public or private, governments, universities, you should start asking the questions. Why do we do it this way? Because we've been doing it this way for 100 years. It's not the right answer. It may be, but its odds are, statistically, it's the wrong answer. So there are things that you can kind of grab control of, and every employer can't do it all by themselves and can't do it one-offs. So there's conversations about collaborations, which is kind of what Larry's organization and mine do, to try to bring that thoughtful process of like-minded employers together to solve these problems. But we need to start solving some problems.
Larry.
Closing remarks.
Sure. I think in the future you're going to find employers moving from what I would call an employer-centric healthcare system to an employer-facilitated one. As we ask more and more of our employees to make decisions about when they get care, where they get care, and how much they pay, we're going to need to provide them with the tools and information and the understanding of how to use the tools and the capabilities. We can have all kinds of transparency tools and online support and devices, but if they don't understand the fundamentals, what I would call health literacy and health benefits literacy, we're never going to go one way. If I give you an example very quickly, we did a study of how people can improve online physician directories, and we had consumers around a table, and they all looked at something that could, a doctor that could fix something in their family, and we had one person come up to me and said, my kid cracked his ankle playing soccer. I looked on the health plan website, I looked at the hospital website, I couldn't find anybody who fixed broken bones. Why? Because he didn't know what orthopedics was. So some basic information, we have all these resources, and yet people have these fundamental challenges. So if we have to move to give people the tools, the information, so they can make the decisions, and employers provide the resources. So we move away from a system that's currently built on lack of knowledge and lack of transparency and waste and inefficiency, and move toward one that's built on knowledge and data, coordination and value.
John.
You know, I was listening to Larry. You know, it's really funny, and this is in no way casting aspersion on the insurance industry, but I want you to think about it. The insurance industry helped you have a better house. You can't have a house without house insurance, right? And ultimately, they get sprinklers, smoke detectors, the materials that you build in your house, and you understand if you don't do that, you're going to pay a higher premium. I would maintain to you, the automobile you drive is in many ways safer because people saw in the insurance industry as well as be able to say that accidents were expensive, replacing the car was expensive, and ultimately we have better automobiles, I think, in many cases because of the insurance industry. And I agree with you, Larry, that people can make the right choice. You know, I will tell you today as we sit here, 80% of cancer is ultimately avoidable. It is a lifestyle issue. It's not all genetics. It isn't. If you smoke, if you're overweight, if you are going to incur a greater chance of incurring this. If diabetes, I helped to launch Lantus back in the early 2000s. You know, quite frankly, we're seeing what's happening now in India and China is all of a sudden people have a different lifestyle. All of a sudden now we've got 100 million people in China with diabetes. We've got 70 million people in India with diabetes. All of this is dietary exercise. So somehow aligning that also to people understanding that they're in the game as well. Years ago, I worked with Bob Blunden at the Harvard School of Public Health. He issued it was about 10,000 patients and 10,000 people he surveyed. And his survey was, what's driving up the cost of healthcare? Insurance companies, drug companies, hospitals, doctors. It was the usual cast of characters. He also put patients in there. Not only did patients get the lowest score, but of patients, they then 25% of them said, why would you put patients in a survey like this? They're the ones using healthcare. And I think that in more of a consumer-driven marketplace, having people, because I have great faith in the American people, they understand certain issues, even that the $15 an hour people, that they can understand that if they're more of an active participant, if they have more knowledge and understanding, they can help to prevent it. And here's the other thing. There isn't enough money in this world to recover the people that ultimately lifestyle or choice issues ultimately get in the way of good healthcare. So developing a more consumer market and one of better ownership within that, I think can also be a help to drive down costs and drive up accountability.
Just one comment. I don't think it was the insurance companies got your better house. It was the treble damage lawyers that made sure you had this.
Could be, yes, okay.
Just, you know, lawyers in America have stopped bad behavior, not the insurance companies. Just the one stat to keep in mind, though, is, you know, if you go see a primary care doctor in Phoenix, and they graduated from the University of Chicago, top of their class, and she was the best in her school, and you see another doctor in Phoenix, they graduated from the night shop medical school, United Healthcare pays them exactly the same amount of money. And United Healthcare, Blue Cross, pick your poison, pay them 5 or 6 weeks later. That's crazy. But that's what the insurance model has created. So I would encourage you to go to your files or go on the Harvard Business Review and dig up Michael Porter's Reimagining Healthcare. A big, long, complex book. But basically what Porter says is get rid of all the competition at the hospital level, at the health plan level. Really inspire the competition at the provider-patient level, where innovation has to arrive so that the better doctors get paid more for the great work they do and we have a way to measure it. You know, inspire that innovation right there at where we want the innovation. The better doctors, the better providers, the better pharmacy, you know, pharmaceutical industry, work that. But we have created this structure and this shibboleth, but takes that financing out of the way and nobody has that control. Find a way to reignite that innovation.
Awesome. So with that, I think it's a great jumping off point. I know the panel will be here afterwards for questions directly, as will I, and I'll also be available for the book signing in the AZBio booth. And with that, I'd like to thank the panel for a great debate, and it's ongoing.